just a sec. Good bid. All right, so, well, hold on just a sec. Now it's saying I'm about to run out of battery power. Doesn't that suck?
Yay! Awesome.
Note to self, plug it in. Okay, no, we're good. We're good.
What do you throw up for live stream when you're having technical difficulties?
There's never a live stream ever that ever happens in the history of a live stream that where there's not something. Yep. Ever.
So by now you guys can hear some of the people that are with us. Our guests are all on. We've had a wonderful half hour getting connected and getting organized. I want to welcome everybody, all the viewers and chatters and the other streams that are mirroring us. We appreciate your support, and we're really excited to have the Films to Fuel the Revolution Filmmakers panel tonight. It's going to be a great show, and I'm going to go ahead and bring these guys on screen. And because we have so many people, I'm having to give you the whole Google screenshot, so bear with me. And once we get going here, if somebody could just give me a thumbs up on audio from everybody, that'll be great. So without further ado, here's all our people. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, welcome everybody. So I don't know how this is looking on the screen because I can't check it out for failure of equipment possibility. So I'm going to go left to right. You'll see Courtney, who is co-hosting tonight, and before we get started, I want to give her props for putting this together. She rounded everybody up and did all the connecting and introducing and all that, and has been awesome to work with, and it's been a great collaboration, so I'll try to hold up my end. Everybody knows who I am. Beside me is Ian Midgely, the executive producer and director of Spark the Film. Beside Ian is Siku Thompson, the co-producer of Spark the Film. Besides Siku, and on the main screen right now, on the Jumbotron, is Sid Woodward. Sid Woodward is from Grounded TV, the founder and producer and executive manager and all-around phenomenal guy. Next to Sid is Todd Darling. Todd is the, catch me if I'm right on this, Todd, director and producer of Occupy the Farm film. Is that right?
Occupy the Farm.
Yeah, but you're the producer and director?
That's correct.
Okay, I want to make sure. And last but not least, on the far right is our new friend Velcro Ripper. And everybody wants me to give a shout out right here at the beginning. We watched Fear Slide on Tuesday night as a teaser to this. Thank you for being so generous and sharing that with us. And it was an absolutely beautiful movie. Thank you so much for making that available to us.
Yeah, I'm glad you got a chance to see it. And I was just saying it's kind of cool because Occupy the Farm is about a farm occupation, and that was a big part of Fierce Light, too, so there's a connection already between us. There are lots of connections between us, but that's one I was thinking of.
Well, and I have to say, you know, as I was researching all this stuff and watching all these trailers and everything, my weeks got much better because the work all of you are doing is just phenomenal. And I sent a tweet out today that said, I think we are exposed to so much suckage in the world. You know, there's all this bad news. There's all this negative stuff. There's a never-ending storm of negativity. And, you know, sometimes I feel like we're trying to be that lone voice shouting into the wind. And all week, with my hands on all your stuff and, you know, being able to talk to you some and all the emails, it made me realize today that, you know, another world is not only possible, it's already being built, and we just don't hear about it. So we're grateful for all of you guys to be showing us what that looks like and what all these people are doing. It's a phenomenal effort on your part, and we're grateful. So we'll launch right into it. And, Court, did you have any opening thoughts or commentary that you wanted to share before we kind of get into the conversation?
I'm just really excited to have everybody here and that everything's going so great, and I appreciate all the hard work of everyone. Working with the team on the Spark has been super fun and awesome, and with everyone, really. So it's great. Yay.
Yay. Okay. And I'm honored and humbled that you guys let me participate. So why don't we go around the table with the producers, and maybe you guys could introduce yourself a little bit better than I did. Tell us again what project you're associated with and what your home base is. So we'll start with Ian, since he's closest to me.
My name is Ian Midgely. I'm the creator of The Spark. The Spark's a film about what ignites the drive in people to change the world around them in a significant way. I spent a year on the road traveling around visiting all kinds of sustainability and social justice projects, basically around the perimeter of the country. I came back here and met up with friend Siku, and she came out as a producer. We're out here in Los Angeles in a warehouse in a nondescript neighborhood where we create magical potions to save the world.
Yeah!
So you're in L.A. Are you in L.A. now as we speak, both of you?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. And Siku, hand it over to you. Give us a little intro and bio.
Yeah, it's pronounced Siku. It's spelled S-I-K-U, but there's no H. But I'm from Los Angeles, not originally, but the past few years I've been living here. And I've been working on documentaries probably off and on for the last 6 years. I worked on my first documentary, was Pack Rat, which was about hoarding. And the last film was also like a very freedom-driven film called Libertopia that was directed by Christina Heller, who's my co-producer on this project, The Spark, with Ian. And, you know, sort of like after Occupy, which I was heavily involved in Vancouver, where I met Courtney, you know, we just sort of came from a place where I wanted to be able to use my media skills and savvy after working in L.A., but I wanted to work on projects that I thought were worth the work, you know, to see some type of tangible results from the films that we produce. So I spent the past 6 months actually living in Hawaii at an eco village where I was living the sustainability. I was living off the grid, and I really saw the beauty of how, you know, this is the future. Being able to be connected to the land and also working with community is the thing that really drove people to be happy. So being a part of the Spark team, it just sort of just clicked, and there's all this synchronicity around the project about how not only my technical like background in media, but also just like living at this eco village was sort of like, you know, ding, this is what you guys need to be doing, this is the future. So came back to LA, started hitting the pavements and making sure that this movie gets out there so everyone can see it.
Excellent. We appreciate it. And you know, it's an interesting point. There is a common thread of you know, sustainable agriculture and living that runs through this crowd, which I find very inspiring. So, Sid, what's your story?
I guess about 5 years ago, I started producing online content pretty much straight out of high school. It's just, me and my friends were sitting around one day, it's like, we have all this gear we bought, I was shooting weddings at the time, and like, just we wanted to start getting creative, so we're like, well, let's start doing a West Coast culture show. So we started, you know, meeting up with artists and hip-hop artists and just doing mostly just, like, music and art-related content. And I actually went to shoot my first documentary in Africa. And I'm sitting there being like, I'm so inspired by music and art, but there's so many important aspects of the world that don't always get addressed just through music and art alone. So I started to build the idea of basically creating a network that would showcase the music and art that I love, but also the really important issues that the world's facing. I feel like out there's so many different sources to get really amazing art and news information, let me rephrase that thought. There's so many places out there to get like really good, like, you know, art content or music content, and then there's really good news websites, but there's no one really out there who's kind of trying to bring those two worlds together. And I feel if you can really bring people in with like the beauty of art and music, and also showcase them some of the really important things that are going on around the world, and also showcasing the really important things in the world in a really creative, beautiful way, I feel you might be able to reach out to a few more people. So that's kind of been our goal with the Grounded TV network over the last few years. We've done lots of stuff with Occupy Wall Street, spent some time there, I think that's actually where I met Velcro for the first time.
Yeah.
And then went down to the Belo Monte Dam in Brazil to work with the some of the tribes that were fighting that. Just did one video for Idle No More. And yeah, just being kind of like a lot more of my focus is being kind of aiming towards that aspect of things. So I'm feeling very blessed.
Outstanding. Thank you for being with us tonight. Todd, you're up. Todd from Occupy the Farm.
Hello. So I'm based in LA and I've lived in California most of my life. You hearing me?
Yeah, we're good.
So I started out in print journalism and was encouraged to get into film by a friend of mine. And I thought it would somehow speed things up, and I discovered actually it just actually slowed things down. These things take a long time to make. I've spent a healthy amount of time working with television and film here in Los Angeles, and it sort of diverted me away from the original inspiration to get into film in the first place. But over the last few years, I've drifted back into more political films and was doing some research about urban farmers in Oakland, thanks to a friend of mine, Carl Grether, who worked with me on a feature I made called A Snowmobile for George. Anyway, Carl tells me that I should check out urban farmers, that they might make a good TV series. So I started checking that. We couldn't get anyone interested in the idea. But then Occupy happened, and I realized that most of the same people I'd met doing the research on urban farms in Oakland were at the center of Occupy Oakland. And I figured out at some point that Occupy and urban farming were going to cross paths. And at that point, whatever happened would make a movie. And I didn't know who and I didn't know where, but I figured it was going to happen for sure. So that was basically how I was had my eyes out on this idea. And last April 22nd, I got a text that 200 people were marching down San Pablo Boulevard towards the Gill Tract, a piece of land owned by the University of California, and immediately dispatched some friends, got up there myself, and just went for it for the next 5 months. And now we're cutting film. So that's what I'm up to now.
Outstanding. And then we got Velcrow with the Occupy Love t-shirt on.
Yeah. Yeah, so, well, I've been making documentaries pretty much all my life since I was 16. When my first films were about environmental issues, and we actually, as a high school group, we set up a community cable station. So that was where I started. And then I, made many films. And then I started in on this trilogy, which Occupy Love is the finale. And the whole process started in the year 2000. With Scared Sacred, which was my journey to the ground zeros of the world, looking for stories of hope in the face of crisis. So I went to places like Hiroshima and Bhopal, New York City during 9/11, then Afghanistan after that, meeting the survivors and looking for what it is that gets people through these crises and how do they transform it. And I discovered that was through taking action and having some source of meaning, those two things together. And that led to Fierce Light, which many of you just saw. And that's the second in the trilogy. And in Fierce Light, it was about bringing together spirituality and activism, which is a big part of my life.
Oh, man, Velcro froze.
He froze.
I wanted to bring them together.
Oh, there we go. No, he's good. Why don't you repeat that last little bit, Velcro, because you froze.
Oh, okay. Spirituality for me was always something that was very separated from my activism, and I was almost like in the closet as a spiritual person in activist circles. And then at a certain point, I realized, I was schizophrenic and separated. And the film Fierce Light was about trying to bring those two things together, the fierceness and the light. And at the end of Fierce Light, I have this question about the sleeping volcano is waking up, and that was the sort of pulsing of this sort of movement of movements I could feel bubbling up. And that led to this new film, Occupy Love, in which I began traveling around the world asking the question, how could the crisis on the planet become a love story? And because I decided I would throw out the word spirituality because it was too controversial and boil it down, and I came up with what I was really talking about was kind of love, and especially love in action. And so I was traveling around going to looking at how the climate crisis in particular, and I was asking people, you know, how could it be a love story? And everyone thought I was crazy. And then I was in New York City on September 17th, and I went down to Zuccotti Park on the first day of Occupy Wall Street, and the film got occupied. And I was there for the beginning of Occupy and started integrating that into the film. And then when I started asking that question, how could the crisis become a love story, people were like, here it is. It is a love story. And it started to really make sense. And as Occupy started taking off, when it went global, I headed off. I went to Occupy London. I went to Spain and filmed with the Indignados in Spain. And I went to Egypt, to Tahrir Square, and also spent time in Occupy Oakland. And tying it all together, you know, and also tying together the climate crisis movement, and I went up to the Alberta tar sands, kind of connecting the dots between ecology and economy, those two things coming together from this greed-based, growth-based system of psychopaths that's destroying the planet and our society. So these movements, I feel, are rising up to transform this sort of top-down power model into something brand new, shared power and life-affirming relationships, mutually sustaining, mutually enhancing relationships. And that's what Occupy Love is about, and we're just about to release it.
Well, that'll be great. And since you already kind of told us a little bit about Occupy Love, I'm going to give a little blip of a highlight for that, and then if you want to add anything to it, then that'll be... So what the people are going to see now is a short highlight film from Occupy Love.
But it's also a time of record-breaking visions.
I think that humans are capable of great things. They're capable of love.
There is no love quite like that. The willingness to put it all on the line for your neighbors, for future generations, for the rest of creation.
How could this crisis be framed as a great love story?
You watching that?
Yeah, I can see it. I can hear it. I'm going to blow my nose right now. I hope I have enough time to do that. I'll be back.
So that was great. You know, we have Occupy Love, and we got Velcro, and we got Siku blowing her nose in the break there. So
perfect.
I saw somebody in the chat window saying, "Did they see it?" Yeah, Occupy Love's been doing festivals, so you may have seen it at a film festival. But we're starting with our global community launch on April 11th, and there's community screenings happening all over the world then. And then it goes and starts in the movie theaters on May 3rd. It's starting in New York.
Outstanding. I'm interested in how long the rest of you have been making films. Velcro told us pretty much since, you know, the beginning of time with him. So how about the rest of you?
I've been making films for good.
Oh, sorry. I was going to say 16 as well. It's actually funny because the only schooling I did was at the Gulf Island Film School, which I think I missed having Velcro's for my teacher by 1 year. So I did that the year I got out of high school, so I was 06.
Awesome.
Yeah.
I think the same here. I was 16 when I went to my first film school, North Carolina School of the Arts, and did like a crazy immersion program there. And then I ended up going to college and doing the same thing, and then came to L.A. and did the same thing. And it's just sort of been my track for my entire life, I guess.
I started making stop animation films in my closet when I was about 10. I went to film school. That's why I met Siku. We both went to Emerson in Boston, and making lots of shorts and music videos and abstract docs and all kinds of different stuff. This is my first feature.
Great, great. And Todd, what about you? I know we spoke a little bit about it the other night.
Yeah, I had the family's 8mm film camp. But I made my first film at about age 15, and my second film was at 16, and we hopped the freight train with the 8mm camera.
Nice.
And then I went to went to undergraduate and something else, and went to UCLA Film School in graduate school, and have been making documentaries ever since.
Wonderful.
Along with a checkered past of reality TV.
So the question begs to be asked, is reality TV really real, or is it completely contrived?
It depends on which show you're on.
I was just going to say, did we get Sid to you? Because I think, I know for me personally, I find Sid's work very interesting because it kind of taps into a lot of different subjects matter, and not just like, you know, activist stuff, but also music and short filmmaking. How did you start?
Well, I kind of described like the founding of Grounded was just a process of like starting out with just music and art, and then slowly getting more and more into just doing stuff that has more meaning behind it, I guess. I feel like I kind of went over that already with my initial thing. I don't know. Did you guys all get that from my first little bit?
Well, you know, not so much from, but you know, you're unique in this panel in that most of the others are here because they are doing feature films and a feature release, and you're running a network. Grounded TV was new to me until Courtney introduced me to it, and I'm like, oh my God, it's like everything is there. How do you do that? I mean, how do you have like a staff of thousands, or what is the deal?
No.
I just don't sleep.
I've noticed that, actually, because you are online a lot of the same times that I'm online, because I'm also up late and involved in lots of projects, and I guess that's where I find it interesting, because I'm familiar with your work through the Bloom series and, you know, festivals and all that kind of stuff, because I've been kind of involved in that area, mm-hmm. you know, prior to some of the work I'm doing now, but then, you know, the... you know, even to Idle No More in Oakland, you know what I mean? And it's just, you're very diverse and your work is very diverse. And I think it's fantastic.
I guess one thing I could explain is the fact that I kind of coined it vagabond storytelling is the fact that I don't really live anywhere for the most part. I kind of manage to get around just floating, and with everything I do being online, I can float quite a bit, and I find a place to stay for a few months here or there. I actually bought a bus that's currently down in California that I was planning on. I'm still kind of planning on it. I don't know where it's going to go, but I basically want to create like a mobile film studio. So that's kind of,
awesome.
Kind of the direction I'm going. But I guess it's, just the format that we've had, it's just kind of follows my interests in life, and, you know, that sometimes gets a little bit more in the music and arts realm. Sometimes it's a little bit more in the activism realm. Sometimes more in the spirituality realm. So I just kind of like to play within all those realms as much as I can. And I find, too, and I actually have always been really superly, like, really inspired by Velcro's work of tying activism and spirituality together. And for me, I feel that's been just the biggest thing I could have learned in the last few years was from him in that realm. So that for me is being, you know, a very important role within my life and my filmmaking. Yeah. So,
well, let me play a little highlight from your trailer for everybody, just to kind of get the visual imagery in their head. So I'm going to run that right now. So this is a highlight of Sid Woodward's Grounded TV network, and you can get a little taste if you didn't see the trailers during the pre-show. It gives you a little taste of what Sid's up to.
I feel like festival culture is providing as a launch pad to explore those realms that we're all curious about in ourselves.
Yeah, people growing food. I think it's an environmental, political, spiritual, and social movement. You know, it's happening with us out here in the country and people in the city too. It shouldn't take a war or a communist regime to have people grow their own food in a city. It's easy. People do it, and it's beautiful.
So that was Sid's Grounded TV, and I highly encourage everybody to spend some time on that, and you'll find the address is in the link pad which clearly has put up for everybody, and I will be taking questions off that pad at some point. Do you guys all know each other's work, or are you all new friends brought together by this little project?
You brought us together.
I know Sis, and I know Courtney, so.
Yeah. I've been somewhat familiar. It's actually a funny story with Velcro here. I was with Occupy, and I was at one point, I was sort of like, beginning of Occupy in Vancouver, and I was kind of like, I want this to be about love and not all this anger, and I Googled on like Facebook, Occupy Love, and I'm like, oh, someone else has already started it. And I wrote to, I didn't know it was Velcro at the time. I thought it was just whoever was doing this like Occupy Love project, and I was like, I'm all about it. Get me on the team. I can't wait to like be a part of this part of the movement. And it turns out it's a film, and here we are sitting on the
well,
together. So. Awesome.
And we actually also were very lucky because we also had Ian. And the buttons, like, see the button?
I've got
my little button on, right? But Ian and his, like, never-ending bag of buttons. And so for people who don't know who Ian is, he's the other producer on the film for Occupy Love.
And it was actually Dale from Occupy Vancouver that designed the buttons.
Yeah, Dayla and Chris, Red Scarf, and and so Ian had this bag of buttons, and, you know, there was at one point an event in Vancouver that showed some of just the short videos leading up to Occupy Love, and, you know, there was a table, and it was just full of all the love buttons, and, but it's interesting how we're all kind of connected. I think I pretty much have spoken with and worked with at some point or another everybody on the panel here, so it's pretty awesome. I'm glad you guys could all come.
Yeah. We've definitely featured everyone's work. I think we've featured all of you guys' work in some way on the network. I just want to quickly say we're actually totally relaunching the network in about a week, the brand new website. It's going to be groundedmedianetwork.com. So we're actually doing away with the TV. We want to detach ourselves from that word.
I actually wanted to add, Mark, you were talking about we're all doing features, but actually, you know, Occupy Love and Fierce Love Films, when we were shooting the feature, we put out a lot of shorts all the way through the whole process, short films, and some of them really went viral. Ian in particular did too. The Revolution is Love and Sacred Economics that are like 300,000 views on YouTube. And I think that those short videos that we release while we're doing the features are a really important part of the process, because features take so long, but the shorts can kind of be this up to the moment in the, you know, as things are happening, reflection. You know, they reflect and catalyze. And I think that's what Sid's work does so beautifully.
Yeah, and, you know, we're familiar with the, I just blanked on it, the Sacred Economics film.
Right. Charles Eisenstein.
We played that a good bit on our channel. It's a fabulous, fabulous film. You bring up an interesting point, and I'd like to get everybody to weigh in on this about, you know, what formats do you prefer, short or long? You know, like you said, a feature film takes forever. What about the short, quick hits? Let's have a little conversation around that.
I like doing short things. You don't often get a chance to do them where you've got a whole lot of control, because you use it in my case, frequently for television. But like while I was doing Occupy the Farm, I tried doing like daily reports, like, you know, Occupy the Farm reports. And at some point, events sort of outran me, and I was unable to continue it. But there is something cool about doing a short bit that can get out quickly. That's just a very short snapshot. Can't be very complex, but you can still get the vibe out of something. And I think it probably, as I was speaking for myself, but I dare say other people feel the same. Sometimes you want to be able to do something brief, short, get out fast. But the enjoyment of doing something complex and longer—that's you take. You know, it's done painstakingly, is that's also enjoyable and important, because you can't, you know, a feature film is a bigger thing than just a whole series of small things. Every small thing has got to have its own internal logic, it's got to be very brief. A larger piece can have a much more complex flow to it. So they're really platforms for different kinds of ideas, and, you know, so I think everyone's going to feel the pull from doing one or the other all the time.
Yep. And Siku, you and Ian both in your biography and your little conversation, you guys come from a tradition from schools that where you did a lot of short work. How do you guys feel about that now? Do you still enjoy doing shorts?
I love doing shorts. I wish I had my money back from school and actually did a little bit of the non-traditional way of filmmaking, which is just, you know, going out there and making it. But, yeah, Ian and I think I met Ian was on one of the first music videos I directed. We just, I guess, at Emerson, it's one of those things where the culture is less heavy on academics, more on co-curricular activities. So most of the individuals there who were really into filmmaking were on sets every single weekend, producing, shooting projects outside of school, and it was almost like school was secondary. As did you have the same experience, Ian?
From school and afterwards, my friends and I had a small music video company when we got out of college out here in L.A. And through all of that, through school and afterwards, I must have worked on at least 100 short films at this point, you know? And that's like, the awesome thing about shorts is you produce something and you get it out there so quickly, and it feels really accomplished to have made something, stamp it, it's out there, people are seeing it, and that's really cool. And the feature process so far, this is my first feature, and so I'm kind of in the midst of post-production right now, and it's tiresome when you're working on something for so long, and it takes a really long time to actually get it out there and to get the feedback on it and to make an impression on people. So shorts are really great. They're a really awesome way to get out something that can be really powerful even in a short amount of time. The thing that's awesome about features when I was drawn to it is that whenever I was making short films at film school, I feel like a lot of the story that I was trying to create was something that was bigger than fit in 3 minutes or fit in 7 minutes. Mm-hmm. And to give someone a really deep experience, it takes a little bit more time. It's kind of like if I hung out with you for, you know, 3 minutes at a party, you get kind of like...
Why did he get stuck?
I think Ian got stuck on that thought, so...
I think he did, too.
But
Ian, you're frozen.
Like, would you rather be a dragon or a unicorn in the life of that? That's a lot different than having like a 2-hour deep conversation about life and learning my whole perspective.
Unicorn.
Great. Totally got stuck.
Back.
Came back. Want to be a dragon or a unicorn? Oh my god,
that was the soundbite for the night, man. Would you rather be a dragon or a unicorn?
Definitely.
That's
awesome.
What I have to say about short films.
Everybody has to answer that question.
I want to be a fire-breathing unicorn.
Winning.
Not thinking outside the box.
I love the chat. What
are
you talking about? Anyways.
You know, these projects, you know, are pretty involved. I was wondering, what roles do each of you play in your projects? Like, are you a do-it-yourself total shop, or do you have people you work with? I mean, I don't know that much about feature film production or running a network, obviously. But Todd and I were talking about this last night. It's a heck of a lot of work, every bit of it. And I think, you know, Todd just touched on it. So what roles do you play in your work? Do you write, do you produce, do you direct, do you market, you know, and what's that, you know, how does that all fit into the bigger vision?
Me?
Whoever wants to answer.
I've personally always been like a one-man show. I have interns I've worked with at various times, but for the most part, it's always been the one-man thing, and I personally really like it, especially just with my lifestyle of kind of always being on the road. It's like, I've kind of mastered, like, okay, I know what I need, I know what I need to go get, and it's good. But it's actually, I'm really excited. One of our big projects for this year is the White Crow Farm Project, and my girlfriend is actually a filmmaker, and we're collaborating on it. This is our first project we're doing together, so I'm really excited.
Where's the White Crow Farm?
The White Crow Farm is a farm that's in Nelson, B.C.
Okay.
And, yeah. Yeah, the series itself is going to be, it's like half based on the farm, half based on similar projects that are happening around North America. So maybe you guys can all, hopefully he'll link everyone to the teaser for that, but that's kind of my big undertaking this year. But I'm really excited, though, to have finally take on a project where I'm doing it in full collaboration with someone else. So it'll be a learning experience for sure.
Yeah, it's fun working with other people. I like other humans a lot. I personally spent a lot of time in a room by myself the past year, and I much prefer working with Siku and other people now that I got some partners.
Yeah. Sometimes I joke that independent filmmaking means that when you look around the room, you're the only one standing there.
Yeah, exactly.
It's fun to work with other people. I've had the opportunity to work with like really big crews, and sometimes it's really sort of confusing to figure out, oh, you've got to shut up and let other people do the work. It's a good thing to learn. And then a lot of time just, you know, being a one-man band, you know, on the frozen prairie of Wyoming by yourself, wondering what you're doing. But it's fun to be able to have more help than just one person. I mean, I find when I'm working by myself, something always suffers. Like I always, you know, it's good to have a sound person with you. Always happy to have someone with sound. Because you can multitask and do a whole lot of things, but the more things you do, the greater chance that something's going to sort of fall off. That's just a lot.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, and then the challenge, though, is if you're working with, I shot my whole film by myself, but I would like to be shooting with other people, but I don't know what other people's experiences have been. Do you find a difference when you have more than just you in the room with your subject? Is having, like, a crew of three or more people in a room change the situation, or is it easier to get an intimate relationship with your subjects when it's just you? What have your experiences been?
Well, for me personally, I don't want more than one other person for that exact reason. I really find that if there's too many people, and who I'm working with is so important, they have to create a safe space for the, especially if you're doing interviews. So for me, it's almost more than their skill set is just their way they are with people, the way they interact with people. And there's a lot of traveling, so how they are to travel. With Occupy Love, I started out working, Ian McKenzie came on board as my intern, and by the time we finished the film, I consider him my mentor. So
Ian's a pretty amazing guy. Yeah, we tried to have him come on as well, but he is just, he's also got a lot of projects that he's working on, and he's been doing crowdfunding workshops for people all over the place. So that was why he couldn't be on the panels, because he's off and running doing his inspirational crowdsourcing workshops, and he's awesome. And, you know, I remember being at the showing in Vancouver of the short clips, the short video clips leading up to Occupy Love, and Ian, you know, somebody asking the question of, like, well, how did you end up, you know, working with Velcrow? And Ian saying, well, you know, I just kept sending him emails and, like, bugging him, can I work with you? Can I work with you? Can I work with you? And then finally he was like, yeah, okay, sure, great, I'll work with you. And
he was relentless, and I said, well, I'm going to the Alberta tar sands, I'm hot, you know, you want to come up? And he said, yeah, let's go. So he came, and that was our sort of test run, and we filmed up there together.
He spoke about that here in Fall River during the screening of Occupy Love. He was here with us, and it was incredible. We got to spend some time together. It was great, but he spoke to the audience just prior to the film, and afterwards he talked about that footage of you guys in the plane and how, he didn't want to be more airplane sick than you because he was, you know, trying to make a good first impression.
I was like, I'm about to throw up, dude. Can you film? He's like, okay. Yeah. And I didn't know that he was about to throw up.
He was so sick. He told us all about it. It was awesome.
So, go ahead.
I was going to say that about working with other people. I've been fortunate with the sound recordist. Usually a good sound person is a very sympathetic individual, and they tend to be quiet. But I have had cases where, directing a reality TV show where you basically have to, you know, shoo the crew away because they're just like glassy-eyed staring at the people who are in front of the camera, and it just totally ices everyone. And it can be very destructive. And so when you have a crew, you do have to manage the vibe on the crew and make sure everyone is, you know, sort of in accord with the project, in accord with the vibe of what's going on. And if they're not, you have to part company with them because it won't work. It can be destructive. You have to be careful with it.
I think that's a really important point, and it's something I've learned over the past couple of years in the things that I do, is that you just have to have people you can gel with, and that's not everybody, and so you just kind of find the people you can work with and do stuff. So it's encouraging to hear that's not a unique experience. I'm going to digress from my guide a little bit, and Courtney, do you have the chat open by any chance?
Yeah. Yes, I do.
Let's try to catch some of these chat questions that are in bold so the people won't think we're ignoring them.
Okay. I'm just going to scroll up a little bit. It looks like Zena is the last question when I scroll up. Was how do you guys choose which film to make?
That's a really good question. For me, it's about... because it's with a feature, it's going to be like a 3 to 5 year journey. So it's got to be something I'm really passionate about. Mm-hmm. And it's got to be something that is part of my own personal journey. So for me, the films are my personal journey. Every film transforms me. So that's how I decide. It's almost like it's got to be a film I have to make. Mm-hmm. That's how I do it.
Yeah. It chooses you.
Yeah, it does.
It's like, it pretty much hits you over the head. You've got to do it. I mean, the film Occupy the Farm, there's nothing I'd rather be doing right now. I'm doing exactly the right thing. I'm completely down with it. So it's great.
Sid, how about you?
I think especially as independent producers, though. Independent filmmakers, if you're not doing it for the passion, I mean, there's no other incentive. So it's funny because some people, we interview people that come on board and work on our film, and you can tell that they're not really passionate about the project. And when you're working on independence, that's pretty much the thing that drives it from production all the way to post and to make sure it gets in front of the viewer's eye. So I think if you're out there and you want to make films, start with your passion. Otherwise, go to school and do the whole studio thing. You can get jobs, but you're not going to be necessarily happy doing this job.
Yeah. Sid, I was wanting to hear your answer to this question, because you do so many different things, so many different subject matters. What catches your attention and you decide it's worth investing on?
Just first of all, Courtney, is that your dog in the background flopping around?
That's my dog, and he's
really loud.
He's got anxiety problems. Down, please.
It's just almost kind of hard to hear over top of it a little bit, just.
Stay.
Tie his leg to his tail or something.
It's just it's the hardwood floor and the nails, okay. And he's an old man. I'm sorry.
Okay. That's all good. Just, I thought I'd let you know. As for that, for me, it's, I guess, a big mixture of things. It's where my passion lies at the moment. And right now, for me, it's like getting back to kind of my roots, where I grew up on a farm, and I'm just recognizing the importance of that within our society, and just how at the core I feel like the main thing of healing is getting people back connected with land. So I want to promote that as much as I can and use the platform that I've created to do so. For like my main project right now being the White Crow Farm project, that's kind of where, my passion just kind of comes from my past and just, paying attention to the world. But on a whole, with what I do, kind of varies. I'm actually leaving to the Congo or the DRC next month for a week to do a short documentary with a First Nations woman from Canada. And that was something that just, I sent my buddy a Facebook message. I saw a project he was doing. I'm like, hey, I'd love to help you. He's like, well, I'm good for that, but I have this other project going on. I mean, a filmer. And it's like, oh, okay. And now I'm kind of in somewhere where it's like, I wasn't really totally paying attention to what was happening within the Congo, but here's an option, this thing comes up where I can do really amazing film projects. And, there's that, I love that element when you kind of are doing the freelance filmmaking thing, is just the options that come out of nowhere sometimes. For me, it's just kind of, it's a big mix of things. I can't really say there's one certain thing.
But so. Again, the common thread of it's whatever interests you and whatever your passion is. And Ian, are you kind of on the same wavelength with that? Do you and Siku compare notes and come up with a project, or you just kind of, it organically evolves?
Well, when I started making this film, it was basically a different idea. So I'd say the film kind of changes over the time. I think that maybe Velcro can relate to that with what he's been doing, too. Where it's, I'm sure everyone can, too, but it's like the journey that you start with might not be where you end up. The film I was making was originally just about alternative lifestyles. And it was about creating your own reality. And then when I was out there and I met some people like Nat Turner in New Orleans and Marcin Jakubowski in Missouri, these people changed my perspective of the world and realized that everyone can't create their own reality. And so then the film became more about making that access available to everyone. So it changes, you know, over the past 3 years.
Yeah. Sorry about that, guys.
I'm going to play Ian and Shiku's trailer, little snip that I have, and just to give you, because I love this movie. It's beautiful, and I'm obsessed with the Open Source Ecology Project. It just blows my head apart. So I'm going to play this trailer a little bit and remind people what you guys are working on.
Great.
Opportunity to evolve and work on solutions.
There's so many different solutions to take.
Or, you know, I have so many things to say about the spark. Oh, look, there they are.
Resist. We resist and resist and resist and we smash the state like awesome. But then what?
It's like my dream come true. I had the opportunity
when
to
I came down here,
hang out
I was
with
looking at a bunch of kids and Laura
and
I who had plenty of family problems.
Film way back when it
who
was
have
still VR God.
Plenty of
and
yeah,
now I get to help
problems.
With the
idea
with all the social media and everything. And it's just been so amazing because I'm so excited about both of the projects.
Is
really,
the status quo of today.
And
yeah. Absolute abundance.
Like artists are saying,
we're excited to have you on board.
Humans is very much corrupted and post.
Oh yeah, now we have a social media
we're connected more closely. To the natural resources from where all the wealth comes by the fact that we have the means, the tools to transform those resources into the feedstocks of modern civilization.
It's challenging. It's not impossible work. It's just hard.
Unleashing access for the common man.
Why should we stop the education at the classroom door? The world can be a laboratory.
We're creating history right now.
So that was the Spark trailer. Beautiful film, guys. I tell you, it's wonderful.
Thank you.
I want to jump back to some of the chat questions, so I'll take the next one. There's a question from Bonkers 2. When making these films, have you guys ever experienced any resistance to you being at a location or on site? Which is a good question, right?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
let's talk about that.
Well, for sure. One of the experiences I had was funny. I was in Asheville, North Carolina, and I was filming at a primitive skills festival where everyone's kind of like making fire out of sticks and skinning roadkill and a lot of kind of like grain hopper community I've been hanging out with at that time, but like I felt like a fish out of water, and I was seen as a fish out of water too, this dude with a camera coming in here with everyone wearing like buckskin pants, and that was kind of a funny situation. And just some of the like more underground communities would be a lot really uncomfortable with the camera sometimes, depending just what, if you fit in with the culture that's there, if they're, I feel like sometimes people are more that are more used to cameras or more aware of them, and it might worry them out more than people that are completely unfamiliar with them.
Mm-hmm. I had an experience once where I was shooting a documentary about hunt sabs, you know, hunt saboteurs who try to stop trophy hunting of bears.
Uh-huh.
And we managed to actually go on a bear hunt pretending we were CBC reporters. We didn't really look like them, but we did our best. And so we were actually on a trophy bear hunt. And we filmed these hunters shoot a bear, which is the most sad, pathetic thing you can ever imagine, because they just drive around in clear cuts and find a bear and shoot it and don't eat it, just cut off the head and put it on the wall. That's what they do. And so we filmed them, and right after that, I think they realized what we had just filmed. And we're all sitting around the campfire that night, and it's dark, and there's this dead bear hanging from a hook somewhere. And they're saying, how do we know you're not with Bear Watch? Because Bear Watch is the hunt sab group, you know, who we've been hanging out with for the last 6 months, you know, filming. We're like, oh, no, oh, no. And they're like, you know, it all just comes down to who's the most accurate shot now, don't it? And so that was the most sort of nervous I ever got around filming. We did get out of that one alive.
We had a pretty interesting experience when we were in the city that's close to the Velamacha Dam this fall. And it was the last day, so we were there for 3 weeks. And the last day, we have a guy come to our place. He's like, hey, just so you know, like, the Federale are coming for you guys. They want to ask you a bunch of questions. And this is at the very beginning of our trip, so we're like, worst that's going to happen is, like, we're about to get kicked out of the country. So we're sitting there all morning. Like, they're like, okay, they just wanted you guys to wait for, like, they'll come talk to you guys in the morning. So we're sitting there just waiting. Waiting, and eventually, like, we're like, well, our flight's in an hour, so, like, let's go to the airport. We're kind of like, maybe they're going to be at the airport waiting for us. And sure enough, they're not at the airport either, so we're like, okay, got our flights, and luckily that was it. we escaped the Brazilian police, but yeah, that's the only thing I've really had that's been that crazy.
I've had a few dicey encounters. The very first film I made, I was shooting down along the border near Tijuana, and I'm on a dirt field. All of a sudden, I notice these little puffs of dust on the ground around me, and this kind of little pop pop sound. I realized someone was shooting at me.
Oh my God.
And I departed quickly. But you know, for the most part, it's, you know, if you have a camera, you can be in dicey situations. But I've been fairly lucky. I think that the big thing though is, like, when you walk in with a camera, you are, you know, you are sort of disrupting the scene, and you've got to be. I mean, I remind myself, like, to be, you know, proceed with a certain amount of care, and you wind up explaining yourself. I mean, certainly in the context of Occupy, you need to explain yourself. You know, who are you shooting for? What are you doing? What are you up to? And and sort of be, you know, as much in accord with the situation as you can be. Because you will, you know, you can't just assume, you know, the privilege of the camera. Because I can't stand it. One thing, I, you know, working in L.A., I recognize the way people get when they've got a camera on their shoulder. You know, put a camera on a shoulder and a walkie-talkie on their hip, and they get this swagger, and it's just kind of, really, dude, you know? And you just don't want to... Yeah, but it's easy to fall into, and it's important to avoid, you know, because you are, it's, the camera does bring a heavy presence, and you are changing the situation by doing that.
I find so much that the camera being there present just changes the situation entirely, too. Like, when I was in the Lower Ninth Ward filming, it's a violent place sometimes, and there's just none of that when I was there. People will act totally different, you know, much less threatening in certain situations throughout the country. And I also find, though, that a lot of the craziest stuff just happens off camera. That's kind of like the rule of documentary filmmaking, I found.
Yeah. I think, for me, my number one rule is respect, and I really feel strongly about that. I come from a place of respect, and it's, the situation is more important than me filming it. And if there's something going on and they don't, people don't want it filmed or whatever, I always make that really clear. I say two things. I say, let me know if you don't want me to film, and if I film something and you don't want me to use it, let me know, because I don't have to use it. So I really try to introduce myself to the groups and the people that I go into beforehand and make that really clear, because I really respect that with people. But also, I tend to come from inside the movements and the place situations that I'm filming. Very rarely am I out filming bear hunters. Usually I'm filming people I'm really aligned with, and that some people criticize me for that. Like, I don't really have those bad guys, so-called bad guys, in my films. I really have people that I'm on side with, but that tends to be my approach. I'm not like a Michael Moore that goes chasing around trying to trick people into saying things. Which is interesting.
That's a great point to make, because the whole thing about the camera, and it can be an awfully invasive thing without that intention. But, you know, I think the note about being respectful of the situation is incredibly valuable. We had a question from Rousselis, who asked, as filmmakers, which interviews have taught you the most about yourself? And why?
Wow.
Dead silence.
I was going to say, you know, you've had so many of them, you know, knock your socks off. You know,
yeah, it's hard to pick one, right?
Ooh, yeah.
It is.
Yeah.
Our chatters ask really good questions, too. You know, a lot of the folks that are participating via the chat have been with a few of us for a very, very long time, and they ask very thoughtful and provocative questions. It's pretty awesome.
I feel like interviewing is not always a process where it knocks my socks off. I kind of like, you know, people love talking about, like right now I feel great of talking about myself. I feel like a therapeutic situation. But really, like, I feel like a good interview kind of like has an arc to it. It's kind of an art piece in its own regard, where I feel like the interviewee should feel fulfilled at the end of the interview too. And I think that a lot of the best interviews are where like the interviewee, him or herself, like has their own socks knocked off too. You know, those are the ones that I feel really good about, when we both come into an understanding about the interviewer and the interview about something together, where it's a real conversation and like a great night out together talking about some deep philosophical stuff.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I'd say one for me a while ago was I did an interview with Gift of Gab, who I don't know if you guys know, but he's in the top 10 of my favorite hip hop artists.
Yeah.
I was actually, I think, the fourth person to interview him, and by the time he came out, I was like, hey man, I'm sorry, I'm going to have to be like, this is going to be really short. I'm like, okay, it's all good. But everyone before me who interviewed him were all from like hip hop news websites, and they only talked to him about hip hop. And one thing I do with a lot of my music artists is that when I interview them, I'm like, I want to talk a little bit about your music, but I want to talk about spirituality. I want to get into something. So we ended up having this really cool conversation based on, I think it was the same week or a week after that, they apparently killed Bin Laden. And there was this quote going around from Martin Luther King, basically just online, it's like, no matter what your enemy does to you, it's like, you should never rejoice in the killing of someone. Mm-hmm. And I brought that up with him, and then we started talking about meditation and spirituality, and we ended up having like a freaking 45-minute-long conversation, even though we were supposed to like, he only wanted to do a few minutes. And at the end, it was, just for me, it meant a lot, because he like gave me like the biggest thank. He's like, you know, I've never, ever been interviewed about a lot of those questions you brought up, and it just means a lot. So to walk away from interview like one of my favorite like musicians and being like, well, he likes my questions. it felt really good, and it kind of like, it drove me a little bit more to like really take on a lot more of those kind of issues when I do sit down with, say, a musician or an artist. So.
Go ahead. You're gonna go.
I was really lucky in Occupy the Farm, because I was following events, and it was very much, there's a lot happening. It was a rock'em sock'em. You know, six things a day would happen, you'd be running without the camera. And so when I finally got a chance to sit down and actually do an interview with the people who were the original organizers, to talk to them about what had happened, it would like, suddenly the reasons behind things would reveal themselves in their thinking that I had not completely appreciated. And it was amazing how over the course of, three or four interviews, they were able to suddenly sort of turn a key, and all of a sudden like what these guys have done at Occupy the Farm is really unique. And it was just like bingo. It was just like the lights just went on. And those are great interviews.
Yep. And I want to show I want to show Todd's highlight here from Occupy the Farm, so everybody can get a reflection on that. Beautiful, beautiful movie and a powerful story. And you know, I spent a lot of time working on that trailer and that highlight after we watched Velcro's film, and the similarity between that and the South Central Farms, which is, I mean, it was the same story over again. You know, South Central Farms some years ago, Gil Tracks, same thing being repeated. Very powerful imagery. So I'm going to show that really quick. So, and the chatters asked that the panel be quiet while the clip's playing. So I'm going to run that clip really quick.
It's inherently hopeful to plant a seed because you hope that it grows.
People have taken over the land and tried to rescue it.
We brought out the rototillers, then we brought out the compost, and then we brought out the plants, and it was just like, wow, we're really doing this.
We believe that this land should be permanently preserved for urban agriculture.
You say it's a scare tactic. Does it scare anybody?
Well, we're committed to farming this land, and we're going to stay here and keep farming.
The police are the facade behind which the administration hides.
Hey, hey, community!
will not abandon that farm.
Will not abandon that farm.
Whose farm?
Our farm.
Whose farm?
Our farm.
Whose farm to people's farm? Beautiful movie you got going on there, Todd. And you're in editing now with that?
Yeah, we're about 90-95% shot, and we're in the early middle stages of post-production. So we're cutting away here in LA.
So we actually have a couple of aspiring filmmakers, it looks like, in the chat. And the question keeps popping up, and I think it's fair to throw this one out there, and Sid kind of touched on it, you know, before we went live. But what are some of the challenges of being an indie producer? You know, of course, financial is one of them, but just, you know, on a daily basis, what kind of challenges do you guys meet?
I think the biggest challenge...
And how do you resolve them? There you go. That was the part I went.
I mean, for me, the biggest challenge that I can see, because I've actually worked for studios before, and I worked for the television production, so it was a little different from the feature department. But I can tell you right now, the biggest difference is the budgets. Yeah. As an independent filmmaker, financing is, you know, it's an uphill battle. And it's awesome that today we have such amazing technology that's on our side with crowdfunding and Kickstarters and Indiegogo, and a way to directly connect with your audience. Because before the internet, you know, like Velcro is doing now, it's like the luckiest thing you could do is hope for to get into a festival that was going to screen your film on a screen so people could see it, and then hopefully you can get that out on like a DVD or VHS tape. And now with, you know, being able to self-distribute and be able to put your film out there, it's much more accessible for filmmakers to see their films get to that final goal of having an audience. But it's still super challenging just to get the funds up front to make it so that you're not in debt, or you're walking around, you know, with your hands out to your friends and like milking every resource you have, and then, you know, still trying to put out the best product as possible.
Yeah, I think I saw in the chat someone was commenting, because I put it, they must have seen be my Facebook friend, because I put a comment, you know, it may seem surprising, but independent filmmakers are always broke and in debt. And it might look, you know, it might look kind of sexy and glamorous, because we, you know, it is sexy and glamorous in some ways, because we follow our hearts, we're doing our passions, and, you know, but it's, I'm always really deeply in debt, and I don't like those financial institutions.
Well,
my film is against them. So how come?
Well,
I'm in that situation.
That's an important, I think, an important point to touch on, too, when we're talking about things like independent film production and independent media, even, you know, that's it. People just think, oh, it's just, you know, this fantastic, wonderful thing. You get to travel and do all the stuff. And it's like, no, like, you know, sometimes we're eating out of, you know, the dumpster so that we can make sure to, like, have something to eat that day because we have to get back out and film. And it's like, I mean, I know I personally have actually done that, you know, not even just in New York, but in Oakland and other places. And it's like, we're broke. We're all broke. And, you know, everybody just wants to get these stories out there. And it's like, we're all so passionate about the work that we do and the stories that we're just trying to get to people, that all the people who have the money aren't telling the stories. And so, yeah. You know, so it creates kind of this really weird dynamic, right? Because the people with all the money are just producing garbage. Like,
well, that's part of the problem with the culture of media these days. And that's something that I really want to work hard to change in my media creation, is that stories that are involved, that are positive stories about topics that relate to the reality of the world, they aren't profitable right now because people aren't interested in buying them, you know? That's a big problem.
Yeah.
There's something interesting that we talked about before we set up, and that's kind of the new distribution models that's starting up, and this is something that that Velcro has been doing, and we're also doing with the Bloom series, which is the web series that we're producing. It's kind of doing like a community-based screening format where people can buy, I don't know how you work it, but I know like you basically buy the rights to play the film for your community, you do a public screening, you put on yourself, and then, you know, instead of like someone sitting there online watching something and maybe sharing on Facebook or leaving a comment, they actually come together in community, which is something I think needs to happen more anyways, but coming together around these film projects that, you know, many of us are producing. And then the positive side of that is also, like, you know, that conversation is had afterwards and people get to network and, like, say, for example, like, you know, with any... Oh, can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. But yeah, so it's kind of cool. And just seeing that conversation that happens afterwards and just meeting people in the same things, especially around a lot of the farm, like I can see this being really good with, was it Occupy the Farm?
Yeah.
You get a bunch of farmers together and like then they start networking. And it's like the same thing we're going to be doing with the White Crow Farm Project. We're actually now planning, I was going to originally just do like, you know, 15-minute episodes, but now I'm like, well, actually I want to do something long format, mm-hmm. like a 45-minute format, so we can actually distribute it through a way that people can come together and watch. Mm-hmm. And I see that kind of being, doing the bit longer format will be good for that. But I want to, like, if I can start getting my projects through Grounded TV, being something that's actually bringing people together, I'll, like, it'll make me happy. I like that idea, so.
Well, I think that's, like, I mean, a big part of why I'm doing these films is that I want to see people to come together and be able to watch movies that they are passionate about that they will never be able to see coming through like the big media chains. And I know you look at all these great filmmakers on this panel today, and it's like through the internet we're connecting. You know, who's to say that we can't travel and put up shows and have these screenings about these movies that, you know, these mixed communities really want to hear about, and then also tie in like an action with it? Because I know part of our campaign for the Spark is that through our Facebook page, we can find out like tons of events that are happening in neighborhoods, people who are planting in urban gardens or working on trying to get some of these Los Angeles lots available for, you know, the actual people who live in the community to grow food and use that space, and then pump it out through our Facebook channel and say, hey guys, you know, gather around, this is happening on this date, meet your neighbors, meet your community, you know, and use the film as a way to bring about action opposed to making it all about us and this film that we're making. Because at the end of the day, like, the world's not going to change by this film. It's going to change by the people who are actually out there working together, doing the hard work to see the future manifest itself, you know?
Yeah.
I totally want to jump in on that, actually, because Velcro is in Brooklyn right now. And when you talk about, you know, tying all these communities in together, there's a couple of groups of folks in Brooklyn who are trying to refurbish the neighborhoods and start these little urban gardens, you know, and it's like the city comes in and takes away their dumpsters and then is now like giving them tickets, you know, to, because there's all the things they're trying to clean up the neighborhood and the city's ticketing them, you know, and it's, and so I know some of the folks that are actually doing that work in Brooklyn, and being able to say to them, hey, check out this film because this is really going to inspire you guys in your efforts, the Occupy Sandy efforts, and, you know, dealing with these neighborhoods that are just trying basically to rebuild themselves, right? And so it's really amazing because everybody that's on this panel all has, you know, all these different ideas, but it's all kind of going in the same direction, and there's a lot of possibility, you know.
And yeah, I wanted to just talk, because Sid was mentioning the release idea, just to explain how we're doing it. We're basically letting it be self-organized. So people all over the world are saying, we want to show the film. We have this, we're starting our community screenings on April 11th, and then it goes on. And our approach is, if you're showing it for free, then the film, there's no license fee, you can show it for free. We ask people to maybe collect donations for Fierce Sub Films if you can, but it's basically free. And then, and if you're charging, then we ask you to split the door with us, and that's it. It's very simple. And we have screenings happening, like, in Bulgaria. There's, like, 10 screenings happening all over there. They're all free. I think they're part of the revolution that's happening there, all over Turkey, Brazil, all over the world. And we didn't look for these people. They found us. So that's really cool. So we don't have a distributor, but it's kind of a self-organized distribution model.
Mm-hmm. Right. It's a really compelling point, and one that's close to my heart, about the intersection of art and activism and how you can use art as a point of departure for something bigger. And in each of your cases, you're advocating using your movie, using your programming in order to bring people together and stimulate them to action. And that, it, to me, is the best and purest use of art in any kind of form. So much respect for that.
You know, I was going to say, sort of in response to the previous question, that you know, many of us know what's wrong with the world, and we can see what's wrong. I mean, there's obviously more things we can learn about the ins and outs of stuff, but at a certain point, regardless of how many facts we've gathered, being right is not sufficient. And, you know, we've got to do something. Actions have to be taken to do the right thing.
Right.
And we're all hoping that these films, you know, can contribute to that. I'm inspired hearing what my comrades on this panel are saying about self-distribution. I want to learn from you, follow your way. I'm not sure how this is going to get done. Mm-hmm. But because I think having, you know, live screenings in front of people where there is a real crowd and they can really get together and really go, you know, do something or talk together afterwards is important. Not everyone's going to be able to do that. Some it's going to have to be via the internet or, you know, mm-hmm. whatever. But I think the live screening is something that we know that we all is important for our films. We enjoy it. I enjoy going to them. It helps to galvanize people. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I think, you know, coming up with a distribution system to serve what, you know, in Hollywood terms would be called a forgotten demographic, basically the people who give a damn, needs to be formed, and, you know, hopefully collectively somehow we're doing that.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not sure if there is a model. I mean, the model is being developed, you know.
Yeah.
It sounds like Velcro River is you've got 8 screenings in Bulgaria. You're way ahead of us.
We're just starting. I mean, it just came, you know, so we'll see. We're figuring it out as we go along.
Yeah, I find it interesting, too, because we're going to be launching a Kickstarter for the White Crow Farm project, and that's actually going to be a big element of our pitch. Is the fact that our screening, the way we're going to screen it, is going to be this community-driven thing, because we feel like that's actually, you know, a big selling point of the project, be it something that, like, we're bringing people together more than it just being something that people watch online. So, I don't know. I brought that up with I can't remember who it was, a friend of ours, but yeah, and he said that's really important. That's, like, a huge aspect, like, and an interesting draw for people, too, so... I think there's an interesting future there for more of a community-based screening systems. So,
I think I want to toss out another question that I skipped over earlier, but, you know, it might be helpful, especially to the inspiring folks. And somebody's got an air leak or something. There we go. So, creative influences, really quickly, just go down the line and tell us about your creative influences, who inspired you, and who still does inspire you.
Should I start?
Sure.
I would say Stanley Kubrick, Ross McAvoy, the Maisel brothers, Godard, some big ones.
Siku?
You know, filmmaking-wise, I was always a fan of Richard Linklater and his earlier works, and the way he sort of explored the different forms of reality that you can use with film. I think a lot of my influences about type of work I do come from my own spirituality. So, you know, I look to people like Gandhi, I look to people like Martin Luther King, for inspiration to make sure that, you know, whatever I do in my life, my career, it's in a path of nonviolence and trying to make the world a better place. So, yeah, I mean, there's a lot of people out there that have influenced me throughout my career and my life, and, you know, it's just one big culmination at the end of the day.
I think that's a great referencing Martin Luther King. That was fantastic. Sorry, Sid, I talked over you. I apologize.
Sorry. I actually have to fully admit, it's kind of embarrassing because he's here right now, but Velcro has been, honestly, for filmmaking, documentary-wise, has been that for me. Just getting to kind of follow him over the last few years. And I think it's because, like, from a young time, like, when I was a kid, I knew he was, like, the teacher at the Gulfline Film School, and seeing his first film, and just, like, the element of, like, the spirituality and activism for me has been, like, just a huge, huge influence for me, so... And I also have to agree, too, it's, like, it's not necessarily just filmmakers, either. It's more like people and their actions around the world that are, or there's spiritual belief systems and all these things that are equally as driving me other than just filmmakers. Mm-hmm. So I actually probably don't watch as many films as I should. I need to maybe start doing that a bit more. I'm so busy creating that it kind of hard sometimes, but yeah.
Yeah, I would underline all the influences that everyone has already mentioned. I would throw out also the Chris Marker, the Battle of Chile, really sort of stuck in my head in film school. I like the both Andersons, who are currently making films, and Antonioni a lot. I thought the Master this year was an incredible film. I really liked it. So, but as filmmakers, we're probably all open to a lot of sources of inspiration, mm-hmm. and it's not just film and a sort of constant, because I think we're just sort of the feverish mentality that we're always looking around for things that are going on, and we're just open to stuff happening, so
mm-hmm.
I wouldn't limit my influence, my filmmaking influences to simply film.
Yeah. Yeah, for me, I come out of an experimental film background, so I really was quite influenced by people like Chris Marker, and also Kayana Scotzi, which I saw on Acid a long time ago. Actually absolutely blew my mind when it came out, actually. And it was, that really changed my whole understanding of how films could be made. You know? So that was a big influence. And Sid, actually, that's, when I helped set up the Gulf Islands Film and Television School, and I have to say, teaching there and watching all the amazing films that my students actually made has also always been a huge inspiration for me, because so much great work came out of that school. It actually blew me away, because in the school, people go for just like 1 week, and in that 1 week, they write, shoot, direct, and edit, and then screen a short film. So that really inspired me, and some of the programs we did programs for street kids, and we had a program once where we brought in Israeli and Palestinian and Canadian youth together to make films together. And those films absolutely blew me away. I mean, one of the films was all the Israelis played Palestinians, and all the Palestinians played Israeli border guards at checkpoints. And they like reversed roles and made a film about it. So, that actually I got a lot of inspiration from GIFs.
I can imagine that was a... Where did that take place, the project?
On Galliano Island in British Columbia.
Yeah, that's an amazing project.
It's a great film school. Gulf Islands Film and Television School. Great place to go, because it's just like a week or 10-day programs, and there's a longer program in the fall. And you walk out of there with a film that you made in your hands.
Mm-hmm. So... That is pretty amazing, and it also shows the value of the educational component. And I feel like watching all of your work and getting prepared for this show is whether your intent is there or not, you are all teaching. You're showing us a way. You're giving these people to talk to and to listen to, and that you're in your way, you're teaching and illustrating the things that are happening and can be done and are very inspiring. So we're coming up on the hour and a half mark, and I want to be respectful of everybody's time. So, Court, did you have any more questions you wanted to ask the panel? Or?
No, I think I'm okay for the questions, because I want to make sure that we have enough time for everybody to say their Twitters and their Facebooks and... if there's any links or anything that people would like to share. I know that a lot of the chatters, I've been kind of watching the chat, and people are really, really interested in people's past work and kind of looking at everybody's stuff. So I think I'm cool. I'm really glad that everybody was able to attend and that things went so smoothly. And I have tons of things to say about the Spark, of course, because it's my job, but I'm going to let Siku and Ian tell everybody all of the Spark details for you guys, and yeah.
Okay, I want to get this one last question in from the chat, because it's good and I missed it earlier, so I'll try not to butcher it. Do you think the content of your films and your work, like on Sid's channel, also creates the desire on the part of viewers to become part of it, by aiding you. And I think this is the, you know, you're establishing this content, you're on the scene. Do you think the viewers want to be a participant by aiding you in your, not only your content, but distribution and all that? You're stimulating people to action, I guess.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll jump in here. I'm, you know, Occupy the Farm. What the people at Occupy the Farm created, I'm trying to mirror in a way that is interesting and attractive to people, that will make them want to do, will take advantage of the unused and misused resources in their own community and make something good out of them. So, yes, absolutely. I feel like we're involved in essentially a dance with being able to, you know, we meet the subject, we dance with them, and as we're dancing with the subject, more and more people get onto the floor. And that's my feeling about it, my own film.
And the questioner, you know, made a point to, you know, I missed a point a little bit, but they also said, you know, in regards to financial support, like, so does right. the content of your programming help stimulate that if you're fortunate?
Yeah, I think that is an important point. And, you know, I think in the future, Ian McKenzie, he was talking about this, you know, that in a way, you know, people can, you know, can, we could just have, like, people sort of tithe in a way. You know, it's like, you know, how monks would kind of have begging bowls and they get a little bit of money to keep them alive, you know. If a community supported independent filmmakers in that way, like tithing, that would be wonderful. And I think that is happening with crowdfunding and people's ability to, you know, support the work. I think that recognizing that this way if we can do it this way, we don't have any gatekeepers. There's nobody telling us, you know, you got to do it this way, so we'll give you the money. Like, you know, that's a choice we make, is to break out of that model, and that allows us to say whatever we want to say. We all, every one of us on this panel have absolute freedom to say it like it is, which is amazing and important. So I think community support's really important. And unless on a financial level, I say that my work, I try to both catalyze and reflect what's happening in, you know, in terms of the social world. So I see what's happening, and I'm reflecting it, and at the same time, I'm catalyzing it even more. So I'm, like, lighting that spark.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Oh, see, that was
Our tagline leading. Is actually ignite the spark.
Yeah. Oh, that's great. Go ahead. You go first.
No, we love that tagline because it's, you know, ignite the spark. It's like, okay, ignite us. Help us, you know, make this movie, because these movies will not get made without the support of the people at home just saying, you know what, I want to see that, and I'm putting my money where my mouth is. But it's also to say, ignite the spark within you. Like, that divine spark that says, this is the purpose, this is what you're destined to do. Go out there and do it, because if you do it, you make the world a better place. So it's like, we can't really do it without you, you know, because we're one and we're working together to make the world a better place. And I know that's what Todd is doing with Occupy the Farm and Velcro is doing with Occupy Love. We're all here just trying to make the world a better place and get this content out to you guys so you can see it and enjoy it. But it's really about, you know, igniting your world and your community and making sure that you guys have a future that you can enjoy and be happy with. So, you know, of course we need the funding. I mean, I'm sure if you go to any one of our websites, there's a little button that says donate, and it goes directly to some PayPal account or some type of, like, online financial.
Yeah, Kickstarters.
Yeah, but it's like, imagine if our jobs every single day was to sit and scroll Kickstarter and fund people, and that their job was to do the same thing. And the way you make your money for whatever it is that you're doing is because people actively go and just give money. You'll have your Kickstarter, and then Courtney would have her Kickstarter, and Velcro would have his project, and we all get funded. But that's like an ideal world that I hope to live in one day. Mm. But, I mean, that would be really cool.
Mm. Well, and I think, too, I guess just what I wanted to say before we got all sparky, because that's the kind of the thing, right, is like little sparks everywhere make big big changes and big flames, right? But that Occupy Love and the way that Ian and Velcro did their crowdfunding campaign, I just wanted to say that it's a really good example of a successful crowdfunded film. Like, I mean, it's it's a great example. And so for, I think for people who are looking for, you know, what is it, what is a good format to use or whatever, take a good look and, you know, look at the Indiegogo and the Kickstarter campaigns for some of these projects, because they're really good examples on how to crowdfund and how to use things like social media to build your networks and build your crowds, you know, because you can tap into so many different community groups and so many different places just based on interests and common thought patterns and all of that. So, you know, there's lots of people out there who are really interested in all of this stuff and who want to support it. So we have to get these voices out there.
Yeah, I think there's a cool thing too of kind of keeping your Kickstarters or your Indiegogos kind of live after the fact that it's actually done as well. We offer that on our project Bloom series. There was a page that broke, like, it laid out all of our incentives and everything and said, you know, this is going to be going as long as this project's going, because, you know, the funding doesn't end with, you know, the 2 months that we had it up. So we did offer that, and it's like, and but kind of, I think that's a good way to go about it too. So it's like, you know, people, they can feel good about making a donation further down the project, because they get, like, whatever it is out of, you know, the donation format as well. So I think that's kind of an interesting thing to do. So that's probably what we're going to be doing grounded in the future soon.
So let's wrap it up by going down the line and really quickly just shout out the, you know, your website or Twitter or anything you want anybody to look at. And we do have the pad posted for people to refer to. But any closing thoughts you have, and let's bring this one home for the evening.
Well, I'm glad that everyone got together to talk about this. It was a pleasure talking to all these great filmmakers. I think we're all kind of working on the same mission here, and I really encourage everyone watching to just go out and start making their own films about what inspires them. Provide information to everyone around them about how to access resources and share resources amongst each other. You can check out our efforts right now. We're fundraising at thesparkfilm.com. Chico, what do you got to say?
You can find us on Facebook, which is really important because we want to get our likes up, because we're not just putting out content about the film, but we're using it as a social media tool for action in our community. So you can find us at facebook.com/thesparkdoc. We're at thesparkdoc on Twitter. We're on Tumblr. We're on Vimeo. You can even go back into the beginning of the project and watch Ian do some behind-the-scenes bloggies about the making of the film. And we'll be releasing more content as we go along, just to kind of keep you guys engaged. Yeah, and thank you so much for this panel. This has been fantastic. Hope we can do it again sometime.
Yeah, amazing. I just love to be on with all you guys, and it's all films I've been following for a long time. So for myself, I think I can let this go. That is okay. We actually have our new website up. It's not completely public, but you know, I'll let you guys all have a sneak peek if you want. The new web address is thegroundedmedianetwork.com, so you guys can go have a little sneak peek of that. Don't share anything on the site, just you can have, go look at it. But I'm pretty excited with how it's going. But our old website is the getgrounded.tv is our other web address for old sites. So just you can reach out to us through there and Facebook, Grounded TV. I think it's Grounded TV for Twitter as well. So,
yeah.
And thank you for everyone. And yeah, looking forward.
Yeah, I'd like to thank everybody, especially Courtney. Courtney also contributed her live stream from Occupy the Farm to the film. So, Courtney, thank you very much for getting me on this. Appreciate it.
Anytime.
The website for Occupy the Farm is occupythefarmfilm.com. Basically the same thing on Facebook, Occupy the Farm Film. You can also check out the people who did Occupy the Farm at Take Back Tract. And I'd like to thank you all for inviting me on, because I think this, like I said earlier, I think just having this conversation like this is, you know, nigh on science fiction. So I mean, this is kind of the new way of doing things, and it's being made up right now, right here. I'm glad to be invited along to the party.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I also really enjoyed myself. That was a really quick hour and a half. I thought when you said it was going to be an hour and a half, I was like, my God, that's gonna be epic. But I really, this is my first live stream panel, and I really like to do a shout out to the people chatting as well, because I have another laptop open here, and I've been following the chat window too. And awesome. It's really great to see you guys so engaged, and all the links going up, and all your thoughts as you go along. So. Really, really great process. Really enjoyed it. And great to be with you all. And you can find us at occupylove.org. And there's all the links to Facebook and Twitter right there, occupylove.org. Tweet, use the hashtag occupylove. Coming up, you can really support us as we release the film by tweeting a lot with that hashtag and sharing all the different screenings that are going on. I noticed that someone from the Occupy Portland screening is there. And also, I know Dan Dominic's in the chat as well, who's translating all our stuff into Japanese, which is really cool, getting it out there. And so, I'm really excited. And also, personally, follow me on Facebook. I do a lot of Facebook. I'm filled with friends, but you can subscribe. Just find Velcro Ripper on Facebook. I really enjoy my community there, and I'd love you to be part of it. So,
and on Twitter, at Vcrow.
Yeah, at Vcrow.
Well, by the way, since when everyone comes to LA, just three of us are already in Los Angeles. We hope to see you at the beach.
Yeah,
that would be wonderful.
Definitely,
and come to the Occupy Love screening in May in Los Angeles.
I have one question before we go for Velcro, because everyone asks me this. I'm sure people ask you this all the time. But where did you get your name from? Did you rip off Velcro?
I got my name. I was 19 years old. I was at a rainbow gathering, and I was the only punk. I was the only punk rocker, and I had spiky hair, and my name was Steve, and everyone was named Feather and Fern, and they thought that's really weird, Steve. And then my last name is Ripper, so someone came up with Velcro, and that's been nice. My name ever since. But there's a W at the end, so my nickname is Crow. So,
Crow.
There you go.
Excellent.
Got the story.
Well, I want to thank.
Go ahead.
Go ahead.
Just one second. I saw you share the link to the website. It's groundedmedianetwork.com. You put the Grounded Media Network.
Okay.
I just noticed that. Just a little thing. I want to point out. So
well, that's a good thing because, right, you know, that makes the difference, right?
Yeah, for sure.
Yes, it does.
I want to express the thanks of the chatters and also the other channels that are mirroring us. Thank you guys so much for all the work you're doing and for spending all the time this evening on this. I know everybody's hella busy. I really appreciate it, and I respect all of you so much and have learned so much. Ian, Siku, Sid, Todd, Velcro, thank you for being on our show, OPN. And Courtney, outstanding job. Thank you for co-hosting and for putting it all together. We really appreciate it. It's been a great evening.
Why, thank you. Yeah, it's been fantastic, and you know, thanks to you, Artister, and Other Possibilities Network for hosting. You know, when I kind of came up with the idea, it was, you know, through some of the work that I've been doing with the Spark, actually, and you guys were the first folks that came to mind because you guys do impeccable work with your interviews and your panel discussions. So I really appreciate that you guys keep this going all of the time. And, you know, yeah, so thank you all. And we're all in touch. And if you guys want to keep up with stuff that's going on with the Spark and with me and with everyone, essentially, because I kind of tweet out everybody's stuff all the time, you can follow me at CourtneyPFB on Twitter and find all my work on politicalfailblog.com. So there we go.
All right. Thank you guys for such a good evening. Be strong. Get healthy, those of you with the sniffles, because there's a lot of work to do and spring's coming. So thank you guys so much for being here tonight. And we're going to take it on out with the splash screen. And hope everybody has a good evening. Thank you, OPN,
thanks
for all your participation.
Thank you.
And all your support you. And the other channels that are mirroring us. Stay tuned for more shows coming up soon.
Artister, there will be this will be available up on YouTube at some point for people to share and watch. I know some of the chatters were asking. I think they wanted to share the interview with some of their friends and stuff. So.
Yeah, I'll have it up in our archives as soon. I'll try to do it tomorrow, but I just will title it and credit it, and then it'll be available for everybody to see and everybody to use however you want to. So I'll tweet that out as soon as it's done.
Awesome. Thank you.